that springs out of a wall. The bottom line of this book is, it, as it's described by the author himself, the lowly hyssop always related to sacrifice, a lesson in God's ways. The way I summarize the book, and I think this is sort of going to be our banner, not guiding light, that's too strong, but just the banner behind us. You know, when you go to presentations, they'll have something behind them. You know, it's like, hey, this is what it's all about. You know, like, yay. So it's the book of small things. It's the undesirable things that are everywhere that no one wants, that God uses to try and prepare the hearts of his people. All right, so just a quick, very quick review. You know, as I'm preparing these things, you know, I summarized, really, I went through the book, you know, I have detailed notes in them, highlights, all that stuff. And I'm like, and I said this last week, there's no way, nor is there a need for me to go page by page and really like dig it all out. And the reason for that is, and I'm not, this isn't me trying to, you know, build Pastor up or Timmy or any one of us who's been sharing. But a lot of the things that are in this book is basically things we talk about every day, right? It's stuff that we're familiar with. There's Brother Warnock gets into it and shows some examples and some angles that sometimes help us sort of reacquaint ourselves with those truths, which can be encouraging, right? If we're, you know, that's why the word says, putting you in remembrance of these things. You know what? Sometimes we forget. There's days I go through and I'm like, oh. And then the Lord would remind me something, a word or a situation. I'm like, yeah, it's not time to quit yet, right? So, so we know this. We pretty much know this. And so I broke it down. I will go into the book. I don't know how many weeks it will take, but I really, my desire is to get to Brother Barry. And I got feedback from multiple people. Instruction, really, just basically asking me to slow down and not go too fast. And so I think we'll do that without prolonging this, because, like I said, I don't think we need to get into page by page. But there are things that can't be drawn out that did jump out at me as I was going through. I was like, hey, I think that's really important today or right now to sort of pull out. It's like a garage, right? I'm clearing my throat, forgive me. Like in a garage, you have a whole bunch of tools. Right? Like, I remember living at Papa's house, like, whatever you need is there, right? But most days, you just pull your car in, and you go, and you go have dinner or whatever. And then sometimes you're working on a project, you grab this tool, you grab that tool, but the tools are always there, you know? And so some of that is, like, having the Word. That's why it's so important to get into the Word. But all of that is in this book. But the main thought, I was on my way and I was trying to, like, what's the main thought, right? Like, should I ever not get through my notes or whatever? What is the main thought in this book, right? As we go through the pages, we go through the different takes. And it's really so simple. You know, it's such a simple thing. Christianity is not complicated. Okay, people tell you it's easy and then they make it complicated, but it's really the other way around. It's actually not complicated. And it's incredibly hard. It's not easy. Cost you everything. Okay? It's not easy at all. Right? So it's really about this. Ultimately, if you want to get, there's no shortcut. This is the book. That's all it is. There's no shortcut for getting to know God. No shortcut. It's a daily walk. It's a battle. Okay? You have the good days, you have the bad days. But it is real, and there is no shortcuts, because God will not compromise his standard. He will not compromise his word. And if we want to get to know God, we're going to have to do it his way. Right? And so ultimately, see, I'm getting into the notes. Ultimately, all of that, everything we talk about is going to be reduced to one thought, desire. What do you want most in your life? And I mentioned it last week briefly, talking about the law. And I kind of got a chuckle out of the law, right? Because I'm like, wow, the law is actually really fair. It's a great teacher. All you got to do is do it, and you're off the hook. It can't produce life. It can't make you live, right? But that's what they did. They made an idol out of it, right? And we're still dealing with that. But the reality of it is, a great tool. You just have to do it. It doesn't matter how you feel about it. Just do it. But God's after how you really think, and that's literally the latter portion of this book. That's what the brother talks about, is really getting every thought. Okay, every thought to a point where it's just ready and in position. And today I want to just quickly go there and talk about the faithful man. And so I'm hearing my thoughts now. Slow down, Nikita. Slow down. Be a good brother and slow down. But so you guys are with me so far, right? That's the book. I mean, we can talk about, make it complicated, but it's really this. I mean, is it, Lord, not my will, your will be done. And we like to make it complicated, especially as time goes by, we make it about something else. But it's really that. Every step of the way, it's a faith decision, right? It doesn't look good, but what does the word say? So we talked about a little bit results versus methods, right? The world is in the mad dash for results, right? Brother talks about in his book, bigger's better, right? Well, the bigger you are, the better the result. You must be doing something right, which is true. Brother Dale talked about it on his with Ahab, right? Really successful, made Christianity really successful, really feeling good. Right? But not, God could care less about any of that. Well, actually, and we say that, but it's more than that, right? God does care because it's his people, right? And he wants his people to pay attention to the thing that's really good for them, not the thing that's going to destroy them. Okay? So we talked about that a little bit. You know, I have this little side note that I think maybe this will help somebody, maybe not, because I really appreciate it, by the way. You know, because this means a lot to me. The word is everything. And so when every one of you just comes out, you know, comes over and just tells me, hey, I really appreciate what you had to say because it really touched my heart, that I enjoy that, right? Not for selfish reasons, but because a lot of times I know that's true because God will lay that on my heart, so I'll share it. But for you to admit that, I appreciate it. But what occurred to me is it's very important to keep the mind on the Holy Ghost, right? The witness within us, because here's why. And I realize this is sort of a side note. Pep talk is not going to keep us, right? We don't need a pep talk, all right? Because pep talk will get your mind jacked up, will get your emotions going. But ultimately, here's what's going to happen. Every one of us is going to have to face the witness within. You're going to have to face them. Nobody else is looking. And we have to be confronted with the fact that we're either going to say yes or we're going to say no. And that's it. Nobody's going to know. Just you and God. But that's the bottom line. So it's good to be excited. It's good. Sometimes that's what you need. It's like when you run a race. I know Chris runs and he's really good. A lot of times, you know, you feel really, really kind of you're running out of steam and somebody hands you a water on the way, and you take that, and that just takes the edge off just enough for you to keep going. So that's good. I'm not saying we don't need ever a little pat in the back. You know, sometimes that helps. Some of us it helps more than others. You know, some people don't need it at all. But the reality is, that's not really what's going to do it. What's going to do it is us being aligned and saying yes, okay, in secret, because the Father rewards in secret. That's, I think that's Matthew 6:4. Okay, so to produce God life, we must withstand the test of God. That's what we kind of, the big introduction was the 40 years, 40 days, the number 40. I have to say, for the sake of time, I don't need to rehash that. That's on the tape. But the point there is it, to produce God life, we must withstand the tests of God the way. Proverbs 17:3, I really like that scripture. The refining pot is for silver, the furnace is for gold, but the Lord tests the hearts. And if you remember, I shared that on Thursday. It's an interesting progression. Silver, gold, the heart. From silver to gold, that refining fire, the temperature goes up. Okay? So with God, the temperature goes all the way up. That's what Jesus said. He's like, yeah, you're tangling yourself up with peculiarities of the law that Moses told you about, but I'm telling you that there's a way, way above all of that, and it's a finishing way. So we're a people of the way. A people of the way are a people hungry for God. Brother Paul said it, count it all loss, Philippians 3:8. Ultimately, that is what God's looking for, a man after his own heart, and that's without without mixture, right? That's a heart that, we kind of talked about it, you can't fake desire. You can't do it. You can do something and not want to do it.
That's true.
But you can't fake desire. So it's almost like when you look at that concept, you're like, well, that's not fair, God. He's giving you a choice. Right? Brother Dale talks about it too, right? He's giving you a choice of what you want. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, right? And he planted us in this earthen vessels. And it says, it is the glory of God to do what? To conceal it. And it's the honor of kings to do what? Search it out. He doesn't, look. God wants to be appreciated for who he is. Not what he does. And he wants to be appreciated for who he is. And that is a bigger than cosmos statement. Meaning only kings can really appreciate a king and talk on the king's level. Do you understand what I'm saying? And that is what he's after. He wants to develop a people into a point where they can see eye to eye with God. Whoa. It's the word. All right, so that's something that we can be excited about for sure. The problem is it does not yet appear, right? And so that's sort of our collective struggle every day. But so just some notes, reading through the notes. If God was only concerned with the result, he'd already have it. I'm just going to stop because I don't want to go fast on that one. But you have to weigh that. It is a fact. Okay, everybody's concerned about, well, if my own father, my dad used to say it. He had a huge problem with my uncle dying when he was young. And he wasn't bitter, he wasn't upset, but it severed his, not faith, well, I don't even know why I'm on this, but it severed his trust and hope in the goodness of God. Do you understand what I'm saying? He lost hope, and he sort of like went, I guess things are just the way they are, right? So he wasn't arguing with God. He was just hurt, right? So people say it all the time. Why? Well, if God was so good, why wouldn't he just fix it? Everybody, a lot of people do it. Right? Because it's not about the result. Yeah.
I got an answer. They're always blaming God for everything. But there is a wonderful scripture that helps you with that. The heavens are the Lord's heavens. And the earth he has given to the sons of men. So whatever happens on planet earth, man has to take a look at it and say, oh, it's my fault. God did not introduce death into humanity. Just think about that. God did not introduce death and failure into humanity. Man did. Once we consider all of that, people have the idea, well, if God was so good, he wouldn't have let this happen. He wouldn't let that happen. He wouldn't let him. No, he turned it over to you to fix it.
How do you fix it? You get flowing in.
That's it. Yeah. So it's just, it's always, it's, he'll say something, now my mind's going in that direction. I always pray, I'm like, just whatever happens, make sure to allow space for, don't feel bad if I say it, but for pastor to share, because I really want to hear what he's got to say. But that, so anyway, well, that's just, I mean, like Brother Warren used to say, there it is. Whatever you think about it, but there it is. But sort of getting back into that, if God was only concerned with his all, he'd have it already. Romans 11:33 says, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Right? So it was... Now, what Pastor shared, that's really strong, and that helps, right? That enlightens our understanding. Oh, wow, I guess, like, it's not God's fault, right? But it says his ways are past finding out. So here we are under the sun, and a lot of people are engaged in trying to find it out. And the Word just tells you flat out, you won't succeed. What it's talking about is his ways are past finding out, but God's result is better, right? His result does not yet appear, right? And by faith, we enter in into that promise, right? We grab hold of it. By faith, we believe what he said is true, right? That's who we are. We're people of faith. We're crazy people. Come on. I'm telling you, we're crazy people. We do not make sense. All right, you even without the clothes we're wearing today, what we do on a daily basis does not make sense to the world. It makes no sense. And thereby is really a portal for when people watch you, and they'll be like, man, how come this is, do you understand? It's a portal into what God's doing, and they can get a glimpse of God just by looking at our life. For those that have hungry hearts now, that's not, right? Not everybody. Somebody, right? Apostle Paul wrote about it. He said it this way. To some, it stinks. To some, it's a sweet smell. Some don't want anything to do with it. I remember Sister Fran one time, there was somebody who used to go to this church. This was a long time ago. And we mentioned that we ran into them. And they were just like, literally, like, you couldn't see. It was like a chipmunk running away for cover. Like, these are people that were friendly, you know? And I remember what she said. It's like, it's not you. They like you. They just, it's him. They don't want him. Right? So, well, I want to read this portion of Scripture just to get me going. I always remember when I'm struggling, that's what I'm always going to do. I'm going to read the Scripture. So it's you can't go wrong with the Scripture. You know, you can literally just go read that. That will help somebody. It's true. I mean, we know better than that. We know better than that, right? There, we do things decently in an order. We have wisdom. We understand it. Right? No, because there's a flip side of that, because that's part of the problem in the church, right? Am I wrong? There's no order. You get a little talent, okay? You can read a little scripture. You can do a little Google search, and then you go out there, and because you're charismatic and you're good-looking or whatever, and you start talking about scriptures, especially if you got a little anointing, you can really get yourself in a lot of trouble. Because God doesn't change his ways. So there is a flip side of that, right, what I just did. So don't go, you know, we know better. We know better. There's an order. But I'm saying the word is strong and powerful, more powerful than any two-edged sword. It is able to separate the soul from spirit. That's good news to me. That means I can trust the word to when I'm confused in the soul realm to say, I'll just do it this way, and then we'll see what happens. And it never fails. All right. Philippians 2. I just had it. All right. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, that's what this book is about, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You know, it is probably at least one great message there that a great preacher could like wind us up about. But we know this stuff, right? It's what I said right out of the gate. The ways of God is to take a people and humble them to a point where they want nothing else. Okay? They want nothing else. Not to force them. Holy Ghost does not force anybody to do anything. Right? And that's all part of that same conversation that we already covered. But I know Pastor has something, so I want to let him talk. No, are you sure? I'm serious. You don't have to. I really don't need you to do that. I have a ton of notes, but today is family fun day, and I'm enjoying it. But anyways,
let me say something.
Yeah.
As you were talking earlier, you know, I said Philippians. But most people don't understand. We'll take the portion of scripture that he just read, right? We know it's talking about Jesus. But the Christ man, you got to find yourself in that scripture. And where it does, what he's really talking about with the hyssop, you think about what the hyssop is. Me and Sandra, we had the conversation coming to church today. It's the insignificant things. God will take the foolish things to confound the wise. And you know what happens is, and Nikita knows, and Brother Chris probably knows because they listen to my brother, and because he says this all the time, and Pastor says it all the time, human wisdom, human strength. And what happens is what he's talking about, we get a little bit under our belt, and now we cast off the restraint. And we think we can do it because human wisdom, human strength, we got a good job, got this. And really what he's dealing with, if you really think about what he's dealing with, the whole bottom line is the Matthew 6 and 33 principle.
Right.
We might as well get it through our heads. Matthew 6 and 33, it's all about order. God does everything in order. And what he does, he sets the order. Him first. And when we get that in our lives, the order set. Desire. He just said it. When we get the desire set, when we get the order set, everything. That means that whatever God ends up, how we always love and call the blessings, right? They're not going to have any, they won't be hanging on you as something to pull you into anything. Because the pull or the draw is always going to be upward. That way, when all them things start falling off your life, because God wants to, should I say God wants to? Or if a trial or a wind or a storm or whatever you want to call it comes your way, you're not going to be moved. That's a person that can stand in his place. You find it not robbery to be equal with God. Because nothing is going to move you from the place or the position God has set you. We had the conversation. Here it is, right? God puts us in a many-membered body, right? Every one of us has a function, has a part. You hear me say it all the time. We deal with the puzzle piece, right? I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Application. There is an absolute application for that because of the anointing that is in Christ Jesus. But I love conjunctions, but that may not be what God wants you for, or the place or the position that he's put. You may be qualified for, we'll do it this way, this is the way we like to do it. You may be qualified for the apostleship, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, or the teacher. But God may not want you to be in any of them positions. So if you seek out those positions, but he really wants you to be over here to fit in, to fulfill the fullness of what he desires, you've missed the whole point of what God's all about. Qualification does not supersede God's desire for where he sets you. That's what the hyssop is all about. It's a humbling. You think about the hyssop. It was the smallest, most insignificant plant, but it was all over the place. I even did a study, I was saying to Sandra, and sorry, Nikita.
That's okay.
Is dealing with, they even think the crown of thorns that was on Jesus' head was the hyssop because it was a thorny little bush. How it can pierce you. And when God can take something that's insignificant, you hear me say it all the time to you, you are the point of contact, can pierce the very darkness. It's all in your attitude, in your positioning of how you place yourself in Christ Jesus. It's an order. God is orderly. I've done it. You've done it. We've all done it. We've all found in our life, in this walk, whether you want to call it the wilderness or whatever you want to call this, I like to call it the quarry. Because in Solomon's temple, remember, I want to deal with this. How he finished the stones in the quarry. We're a people that God is finishing in the quarry. Because when he sets us, and as he's setting us, you're not going to hear any human wisdom or human strength in God's building of the temple. Go ahead.
Don't apologize, please. I mean it.
So back to Philippians. You have to find yourself.
No, we're on to James. I'm just teasing you. So I want to piggyback off of Pastor Tim here, and just before I just go crazy, you know, my notes, you know, they're supposed to help me do this, but they don't. They get me going. All right. So I'm just gonna read a description of the hyssop right out of the book, really good, because it fits. We can do this, and then we'll go to James because I want to talk about back to Philippians. I want to talk about the faithful man, which is what. Timmy talked about just now. So, mind not the high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Very foreign thought. Very foreign thought. In fact, I would say that to really, really think like that, you have to be in a body. No, I know. I'm just, that came out of my spirit, not really my mind. Because when you are really confronted with that, And you're lonely in that place, all your eyes can see is everything that's in the world, right? I'm not even just talking about sin. I'm just talking about the good stuff from Egypt, right? All the good imported stuff, right? Things that we enjoy in life, you know? So condescending to men of low estate, really, it speaks of the mind, of how you think. It doesn't mean that you have to go out there into the, you know, you understand what I'm saying, right? Not going out there and mingling with the poor because that makes you a great Christian, right? That's not what he's really talking about. It's talking about take that mindset. Don't throw people out and don't put yourself all the way up. And here's the hyssop. Boom, here we go. Much reference is made in Scripture to both the cedar and the hyssop, but whereas the cedar speaks of stature and honor and glory, the hyssop always relates to sacrifice and therefore to humility, weakness, and contrition of heart. Other than this, I knew nothing about the plant itself, but after having been impressed to minister on the hyssop relative to its weakness and sacrificial character, I felt to put it in writing and have since looked up a number of references, books concerning it. But I found, here's some key stuff, some of which Timmy already hit on. It found it grows in dry places, out in the full sun. It is particularly suited to a rockery. And this may be inferred in the statement that it springs out of the wall, perhaps a terraced rock wall. It is low-growing, up to about 2 feet. It's native to Egypt. Interesting. It has strong, wiry stems with bunches of flowers and leaves, produces small, blush, purple flowers. Now, here's a good part. Here's a good part. And has sweet fragrance. It's a bitter herb, but it has sweet fragrance. Now, here's a picture for us. To save time, you can't do any of the process of approaching God. Okay, that's remember, the law is a picture of how to approach. Well, Brother Dale dealt with that 2 years ago with a series on Leviticus, right? But you can't have any of God unless you do it His way. And the hyssop is the piece in how to get it done. You can't do any of those sacrifices without employing the hyssop in the process. Okay? So it's everywhere. Nobody wants it. In fact, after use, it's discarded. It's not furnished and hung on anything, right? Like the cedars are, right? And the cedars, the kings, that's what they look at. The cedar. The cedar is a tall tree, beautiful, right? You can see it. Now, so what I thought about it, it has this sweet fragrance, right? So you have, you know, big halls, and kings appreciate big halls, and they walk around. Wow, did you see my that, right? Like the Queen of Sheba, she went and saw all of it, right? But to appreciate the hyssop, what do you have to do? Think about it. It would be better if you guys got it yourselves without me saying it. Think about it. It's a low tree. Okay? Here I am appreciating the cedars. Yep. Wow. Yep. What do you got to do? Before you bow down, what do you got to do? If I go like this and bow down, I fall. But what do you got to do? Real practical stuff. Real practical stuff. You want to appreciate the hyssop. Again, if you want to get to know God, that's what we're talking about. And the hyssop, that's all the really book is about. You want to get to know God, you got to do it His way. To do it His way is going to cost you everything. Me. It's going to cost us everything. Boom. Right there. That's it. We can go. We can go eat hot dogs. Okay? But the point I'm trying to make is real simple. If you want to appreciate the hyssop, what do you first have to do? And to smell it, you got to do what? The world is in a mad dash. The world is full. The brain just goes 100,000 miles an hour every day. You have to stop. You have to stop. There it is. You have to stop. Go ahead. Stop and bow down.
As you were saying about in the grand hall and you're all looking around and everything, what makes you stop is that sweet fragrance. All of a sudden it hits you and you're like, what is that? And it makes you stop because it's so wonderful and you want to know what it is. And then you seek it out.
Agreed. If you don't walk too fast.
You're led to that flower to bend down to smell that sweet fragrance. You have to stop.
Amen. And so, do I have any time or am I done? Is it 10:44? 10:44. 1 minute? I have 1 minute? Why don't we just call it a day? All right.